While Minecraft Redstone usually relies on the core components provided by the game, you'll sometimes see blocks used in contraptions that don't make a lot of sense as to how and why they work. They don't give any useful outputs in terms of redstone power, so how are they used? The answer lies in this block, the Observer. Hello everyone, my name's Emdy and welcome back to Practical Redstone Reloaded, the series in which I teach you how redstone works so that you can build your own farms and contraptions. Today we'll be focusing on just one component, but we'll be looking at a lot of different blocks that work with it. So let's begin. The Observer is a full non-conductive block that is directional and can face any of its six sides. The face of the Observer acts as the input, while the butt or dot on the back, whatever you want to call it, is the output that powers the block it's facing. The other four sides have no functionality. Observers will always output a pulse 2 game ticks long, no matter the input, because unlike most redstone components, the Observer doesn't actually react to redstone power. You can see this when I power a block on its input side, nothing happens. So what does work as an input? To understand this, we need to understand how the game processes changes in the world. Imagine for a moment that you were coding the game, and you had to decide when redstone components check if they are receiving power. The easy way out would be to make every component check every single tick if there is something powering it. This works, but as any programmer would tell you, it's not a great solution. As soon as you scale it up with a couple hundred components, your computer would be doing thousands of checks every tick, which is not great for game performance. Bedrock Pistons. To avoid this performance nightmare, Mojang chose to implement a block update system to the game. The concept of the update system is simple. Whenever something about a block changes, it tells the surrounding blocks that something about it has changed, which prompts them to check if they have to change or not. There are a few kinds of set updates. We have block updates, also called neighbor change updates, shape updates, also known as post-placement or state updates, comparator updates, which are basically a subset of block updates, and finally, light updates. Block updates are most often given out by redstone components, especially ones that provide power, since components check if they are powered or not based on the block update system. Placing and breaking blocks also sends out block updates, and using the mini HUD mod, we can visualize these updates as you can see here. Take note of how many and where block updates are sent for various components, especially in the case of components like redstone dust and torches, because of where they can power blocks from. Comparator updates are usually sent from containers or blocks that a comparator can read when any change to it and its contents occurs. Even clicking a slot in the container will send an update. These updates go in a plus shape from the block and one block extra if the adjacent one is a conductive block. When we look at the setup I used in the last episode to show cuds, you can see that the comparator doesn't know the chest it's reading is blocked, because no block updates reached it when the block was placed. However, when I so much as click a slot in this chest, the comparator updates are sent and the comparator changes state. Light updates are fairly self-explanatory. They are sent when any light source is placed or activated, and when any block streams the skylight, but there's no way to detect them, so they aren't really useful in redstone. Finally, we have state updates. These are given out on placement and removal of blocks, and when any of its block states change. When I say block states, I'm referring to the various states you can see in the F3 menu when hovering over the block. State updates are only sent to the immediately adjacent blocks, and if you haven't already guessed, these are the types of updates that observers detect. That very important fact is what a lot of people get wrong. You'll hear people calling observers a block update detector, or BUD, but this is factually incorrect. An observer is more accurately a state update detector, or SUD. And the easiest way to demonstrate this is by comparing it with an actual BUD. Why the setup is a BUD we'll cover in a future episode, but for now, let's see the types of updates a BUD and Observer react to. Before we continue with the rest of the video, I want to quickly announce that I've recently enabled channel memberships, with what I feel are some neat perks. So if that interests you, I'd love it if you could check that out. If not, you can still help me end this series out with a like, share, and comment, as that really helps the video performance. Without further delay, back to the video. Now just saying the Observer detects state updates doesn't really explain why it's used so much in redstone. The beauty of the Observer is not that it's an interesting redstone component, but instead it's the fact that it can basically convert other, usually decorative blocks, into redstone components. Let's look at some examples so you can see what I mean. If you're familiar with my waifu iron farm, or some of ENX04's designs, you may have seen scaffolding used in redstone. Scaffolding is a very versatile block, but one of its most interesting properties is its distant state. Since scaffolding can only extend 6 blocks horizontally from a support, the distant state keeps track of how far each block is horizontally from said support. The easiest way to modify this is to have the scaffolding resting on a trapdoor. Opening the trapdoor removes the support, and all the scaffolding above gains a distance of 1. And of course, the observer can detect this change. The distance tag takes 1 game tick to change, so for each block the update travels to, an additional game tick is needed. This works both horizontally and vertically, and is really useful when you want to send a signal vertically with some delay. Additionally, this also becomes a way to get what is called an odd game tick delay. Since all components with delays have them in intervals of 2 game ticks, that is, even number amounts. If you wanted a delay of an odd number like 3, with normal components that wouldn't be possible. But with the help of scaffolding and leafstone, which we'll cover later, we can get odd game tick delays. You can see here that the middle lamp activates after the first and before the third. Another vertical signal transfer method comes in the form of bubble columns, but this time the change happens instantly throughout the column. Formation of a bubble column takes 20 game ticks, but removal takes only 5. Again, Ian uses this in his stacking raid farm to signal the raid center shifters. More commonly in observer wiring, you'll find other redstone components being detected, the most common of which is the node block, but that has an additional reason we'll cover in the future. Other examples include trapdoors, doors, fence gates, and rails. All of these are instant changes, but they are used depending on the way the wiring has to go, or if you don't want to power nearby components. Powered and activated rails are an interesting case and are also commonly used not for their effects on minecarts, but because of their fast, isolated, and predictable change of state. When changing from power to unpowered, the rail furthest from the source of power updates first and then propagates to the source. These rails have an 8-block limit, but there are some wiring tricks you can use to extend the range and make long-range instant wires like Kaizen. The change of a node block's instrument is also a slightly niche but useful detection. Since different blocks affect a node block's sound, you can actually detect a change in the block going under a node block and take a signal from that. Node blocks are also used as an input because of how big and easy to click they are. Right-clicking a node block changes its node, which an observer can detect and run to a redstone circuit. Another funny one I've seen used a bit in storage tech is detecting snowy dirt. Putting powder snow above a dirt block changes it to snowy dirt, which an observer can read. The use is very niche, but it's interesting, so I felt like including it. Also, did you know that skull blocks have a powered state? Well, observers can detect that too. Back to some slightly more practical methods, we have leaves. Leafstone, as it's called, refers to detecting the change in the distance of a leaf from a wood or log block. Like scaffolding, a change in the distance value of a leaf propagates at one block per tick. The order is consistent with the addition of a log, but removing the log has a slightly weird double activation of some leaves because of how the updates travel. Last, but certainly not least, is Wallstone. Well, technically it's not just walls, but walls are the most useful. Put simply, an observer can detect a change in how a fence, glass pane, or wall is connected to an adjacent block. These connections can easily be manipulated using trapdoors or pistons. So as you can see, flicking this trapdoor changes the glass pane, and the observer detects it. Glass panes and fences only have states for connections in the cardinal directions. Walls, on the other hand, have a sneaky state that makes them magnitudes more useful, that being the deceptively simple up state. As you may know, when you connect walls together, there are two main shapes it can take, either flat or with a post where it's slightly thicker in the middle. This applies not only to pure wall connections, but when the walls are connected to other blocks as well. Walls connected on either opposite sides or all four sides will connect flat and not have an up state. Any other way of connection leads to the center post forming. Additionally, having a wall that is a post above another flat wall will cause the flat wall to become a post. Any change to the shape of a wall is instant, and post formation goes down the tower instantly as well as in order. Using this mechanic, we can have easy, instant, and expandable signal transmission vertically downwards using walls and observers. With the help of trapdoors or blocks pushed with pistons, you can change any wall in the column, and with the use of an observer at the bottom reading the wall, we can get an output signal. Some notes with Wallstone. When reading the output of a wall, you can either do it like this, where the wall is a side connection, or below the wall where it doesn't affect it. If you want an output on the flat side, you'll have to connect the wall to something on the other side as well to make it not a post. When you have just one wall being read by an observer, you can detect when there's a flat surface moved above it because the side connection changes from low to tall to connect flush with the surface. Since it's possible to make connections at any point in the column, if you have multiple observers reading a wall column at different heights, only the ones below the point of change will detect it. I think that's enough theory for this video. So how about we go to the exercises? Since we have just one component that's new, and because observers work best with components we have yet to cover, I'll actually just keep one exercise, and that is the gametick clock from episode 1. 20 lamps in a loop, with each lamp activating one gametick after the other. Remembering how to get an odd gametick delay from before will come in handy, and preferably this loop should have an on-off switch. If you have any questions or want to share your attempts, then check out the NubTech Discord after grabbing the Practical Redstone tab. With that, we come to the end of this video. I hope you found it useful. Don't forget to subscribe if you want to see future episodes, and I'll see you in the next one. Thanks for watching!